Good evening. My name is Shalia Ben. I am the Executive Director of the Native American Arts Center at Idyllwild Arts. Thank you for joining us this evening for the Michael Kabotie Lecture Series. This summer, we had the opportunity to showcase lunchtime lectures. They were so much fun that we wanted to put them all together and share them with you online so we could enjoy them once again. The very first one is with actor, writer, and comedian Joey Clift. Joey Clift is most notably known as being one of the writers for one of the hit TV shows on Netflix, Spirit Rangers. We hope you enjoy.
Thank you again for being here and joining us. This is the Michael Kabotie Lecture Series. Michael Kabotie was instrumental in creating the Native American Art Festival Week, and his spirit still remains with us in every sense of the word. And he was also he was like a trickster. He was funny. He would make people laugh. And he expressed his love through humor, joy, and comedy very much. And so we recognize him and continue this the legacy of having the Michael Kabotie Lecture Series. So thank you. My name's Shalia. I'm the Executive Director of the Native American Arts Center here at Idyllwild Arts. I work year-round with two senior program consultants, Taria Smith. She's the editor of News from Native California, works for Heyday Books. And then we have Emily Clark here, former IA alum, superstar writer. She does everything master beater now, and also one of the program consultants working with me throughout the year, and Olivia, who is the assistant to the Native American Arts Center, is also instrumental in the success of this program. I'm going to turn it over to Emily now to introduce our guest, Joey, and also let's enjoy this meal on the homelands of the Kahuilla and Serrano people and give a lot of thanks for that and the opportunity to be here with one another. So thank you. Turn it over.
Okay, hi everyone. So Shalia kind of already introduced me, but I'm Emily. I am an enrolled member of the Kahuilla Band of Indians, and Idyllwild Arts does sit on traditional Kahuilla homeland, so I'm really excited to be here. So as many of you know, our theme this year is exploring humor, comedy, and joy within Indigenous artistic expression. And so in line with that theme, I have the honor of introducing Joey today. Joey is a writer, performer, and enrolled Cowlitz Indian tribal member currently living in Los Angeles. He has written on shows for Nickelodeon, Cartoon Network, DreamWorks, and many others. His award-winning short film, Telling People You're Native American When You're Not Native, is a lot like telling a bear you're a bear when you're not a bear, was listed on the Comedy Bureau's Top 100 Things in Comedy in 2019 and screened at the Smithsonian. Joey also uses his platform to write and speak about stereotypes that Native people face, as well as the tokenization of Native people and culture. He's also a self-identified cat guy, and has created a 13,000 member Facebook group for LA-based comedians to share pictures of their cats. So basically he's super cool and we're really happy that he's here. And so with that, I think let's have a round of applause and we'll welcome Joey.
Yeah, how's it going everybody? Put your knives and forks together, I guess. Before I get started, I just want to say this is such a great program. I'm so happy to be a part of it. Thanks so much for coming up to this, but also Stephen Paul Judd, a really great Native artist, is doing a talk here tomorrow, and I believe Jackie Klee, a super funny Native comedian, is doing a talk here Thursday. And they're just great folks, so definitely be sure and come out and support them too. As was mentioned, my name is Joey Clift. I'm a comedian, TV writer, and enrolled Cowlitz Indian tribal member. And I'm here to talk a little bit about my career, Native comedy, and a bunch of other stuff I'm working on. Before I get started, here's a short film I made a year or two ago that I think does a pretty good job of showing the types of things I make.
Okay, but what would your superpower be?
I don't know. I feel like it feels really basic to say, but I feel like I want to fly.
I feel like it's too cold in the air, though.
I didn't think. I literally never thought about.
Would you want wings or just like Superman fly?
I think I want just like person. Like nothing changes about my body, but I can fly. I'm gonna fly to your house.
What?
It's been so great getting to know you these past few months.
Same. You're great.
No, you're great. No. No, you're my first Native American boyfriend.
And you're my first girlfriend named Emily.
Seriously though, can I ask you a question?
Okay.
Okay. When I was 5 years old, my mother dressed me up like Pocahontas, like from the Disney movie. And now I'm dating a Native American guy. That's a little weird, right?
I mean, it's a problematic movie, for sure. But you're 5. It's fine.
Okay. Okay, good. Also, when I was in middle school, I used to say that Rihanna was my spirit animal.
Yeah, that's a little appropriative, but it's not your fault. A lot of non-natives use the term spirit animal. That doesn't make it okay, but I get that people don't know me better.
Right, because it's appropriative of our culture.
What do you mean, our culture?
Oh, I just thought that since we were dating, it means I'm in the tribe.
That's not really our tribe anymore.
Really? So I should stop telling people on Insta that because I'm dating a Native American man, it means I'm Native American too?
When did you start doing that?
Today.
Ooh, 2 lives! Our ancestors will be so pleased.
That was bad. That felt bad. I'm so sorry.
I get that you're excited to be dating a Native guy. We're awesome. But you don't need to apologize about every racial microaggression you've ever done or assume a weird Native identity to date. I like you for you.
Okay. I'm sorry. I thank you for being patient.
Don't mention it. Anyway, I gotta show you this amazing lookout. It's my favorite spot in the city.
Hey, Johnny.
Is this another Native question?
No! I mean, yes. Are you a werewolf like all the Native Americans in Twilight movies? You have to be honest.
Am I a werewolf? No. No. That is literally insane. That's a movie.
See, this is why Native stereotypes are so harmful. And another thing, Taylor Lautner's not even Native, which is messed up for a whole nother reason.
I'm messing with you. It was a joke. It was a joke. I got you.
You got me.
You got me.
I got you there.
You're such a tinner.
I won't do it again.
Okay.
That was the last one.
Please.
I'll do it properly one more time, but I won't. I'm sorry.
Hey, babe. Do you know why I asked you if you were a werewolf?
Because you're being cute?
No. Because I'm a werewolf.
That's it. I'm breaking up with you.
He ran away. Nice going, Emily. You're gonna be alone forever.
Thanks so much for the applause. That short's called My First Native American Boyfriend. I wrote and directed it, and it was inspired by a white woman I dated a few years ago who, a few weeks into the relationship, shook me awake at like 3 a.m. with a look of absolute concern in her eyes, because when she was 5 years old, her mom dressed her up like Pocahontas from the Disney movie, and now that she was dating a Native American guy, she just had to apologize about it. And my response was, of course, like, it's fine, go back to sleep. Because what else are you supposed to say in that situation? That relationship did not last. A lot of my comedy is focused on the weird microaggressions that Native folks run into on a regular basis. I've worked on a ton of cool projects in my career, but I've walked a really windy path to get to where I am today. That's me when I was a student at Tulalip Option School on the Tulalip Reservation in Washington State. When I was a kid, I had no idea what I wanted to be when I grew up, but I knew that I loved making people laugh. The way that manifests itself in high school is that I made sarcastic comments and jokes in the back of the class, like, a lot. I did it so much that one of my teachers made me change desks 7 times in 1 quarter, with the final move being her making me move my desk into the corner with my desk facing the wall. I was 17 at the time. I knew I wanted to do comedy for a living, but because I'm Native and there weren't really any high-profile Native comedians out there in the media at the time, I didn't think that a career in comedy is something that I was allowed to do. So I went to college for what to me felt like the next best thing, which was to be a small market TV weather guy. There's a picture of me from my college weather person days. Did I have any interest in reporting the weather? No, but TV weather people get to have fun personalities and crack jokes in the air. So this is how I thought as a teenager that I can get paid to make people laugh. When I was going to college, I got really involved in stand-up comedy, DJing for my local college radio station, and doing a lot of college TV. I told myself that all this on-camera and stage experience would be great practice for my eventual career reporting the weather in a small town. I was so involved in college TV that a show I wrote, produced, and co-starred in won a big National College Comedy Award, beating out shows from Ithaca, Harvard, and a ton of Ivy League schools. And when I received that trophy in the mail, I remember thinking to myself, wow, this trophy will look really cool on my news desk in Post Falls, Idaho, which is a real place that I almost got a news reporter job at. Fortunately, a bunch of my professors saw this and gave me the very obvious suggestion, hey, why don't you just work in comedy? Which I responded with a very cool, really? This was around 13 years ago. Since then, I moved to Los Angeles, got really involved in the sketch and improv comedy community, and I've written for shows and projects for Comedy Central, Netflix, Cartoon Network, Nickelodeon, and a ton of other places. I even, as was mentioned, started a Facebook group for Los Angeles comedians to share pictures of their cats. It's called the LA Underground Cat Network. We're up to 16,000 members now. You should join it, it's very cute. I made a lot of fun stuff my first 7 or 8 years in LA, and rather than just list off all my credits, I figured I'd just give you a short video with some of the highlights. Yes, go cats. Okay, and... To underline the cat thing, that's a picture of me wearing a suit covered in cat photos. Wasn't lying, I love cats. Do I have any other cat people in the house? Hell yeah. Please show me pictures of your cats afterwards. I would love to see them. I'm really proud of my career and all that I've accomplished, but something I've noticed is that a big reason I didn't really see a ton of Native people in the media when I was a teenager is that there just weren't a lot of Natives working in the entertainment industry. I mean, even today, oftentimes when I get a job, I'll use my tribal ID card for hiring paperwork, and the producer will almost always tell me, wow, I've never seen one of these before, except a few years ago when a producer told me, wow, this is the second time I've seen a tribal ID card. And I immediately asked her, like, which Native she hired, because Native Hollywood is really small, we're all probably friends. It turns out I did know that person, and I'm glad they got work, they're really nice. Now, you might have noticed in that video that we just saw that there aren't really any Native jokes or characters in them. I'm really proud of my heritage, but to tell you the truth, for the first 6 years in Los Angeles, for me, I didn't really have any opportunities to write about my identity. I felt like I was on two different tracks. One of the tracks, I was just kind of a comedy writer living in LA. writing the same comedy sketches about Batman and other nerd stuff that all my non-native contemporaries would write about. The other track, I was deeply proud of my people and my culture, but for a long time, those tracks just weren't really allowed to interact. When I was coming up in the LA comedy, the LA alt comedy scene, I was the only native that really got mainstream opportunities in that world. I think at the time, I was the only native comedian on what's called a house team for any of the major comedy theaters in Los Angeles. And for those of you that don't know, house teams are the best comedians, writers, and actors at these theaters. They're put together by the theater's artistic directors and are often used as farm teams for shows like Saturday Night Live and kind of all the big network late night shows like The Tonight Show and stuff like that. Meanwhile, I was really involved in Native Hollywood, which is kind of the loose collection of 500 or so Native folks working in the entertainment industry. There's Taboo from the Black Eyed Peas in that picture. We're not good friends. He's a nice guy, though. We're just acquaintances. He's great. Why did I say it like that? I don't know. Being a part of a community of other Native creatives is important to me. So I think I actually got involved in Native Hollywood a few months before I got involved in the LA comedy scene. I volunteered for Native events, went to Native Hollywood parties, and in that world I knew a ton of super funny Native comedians who weren't getting any opportunities in mainstream spaces. And this isn't just my observation, there are facts that back this up. Native comedians have been killing it on the powwow and casino circuit for decades. Folks like on this poster, you know, James and Ernie, the 1491s, the ladies of Native comedy, and other Native comedy collectives would sell out shows on reservations, but comedy bookers for the big comedy clubs and TV show producers didn't often go to reservations to scout talent. Up until recently, pretty much the only Native comedian to break through into mainstream in the past 50 years is a guy named Charlie Hill. He's a super funny comedian, and he was the first Native comedian to do a set on late night television. He performed on The Tonight Show, The Richard Pryor Show, and a lot of other places throughout the 70s and 80s. He passed away in 2013, and his last network late night performance was on Letterman in 2006. A Native comedian hasn't been invited to do stand-up on a network late night show since Charlie Hill almost 20 years ago. And some late night hosts have gone their entire decades-long careers without booking a Native comedian. It's not that the Native comedy talent isn't there. It's entirely what's called a pipeline issue. Comedy bookers don't know that they have a blind spot around booking Native talent. And they're not going off the beaten path and looking for talent in places that a lot of Native comedians perform at. Once I realized I was one of the few Native comedians getting mainstream comedy opportunities, I tried to bridge my two worlds and use my position to boost up other Native comedians around me. I wanted to play a small part in helping build that talent pipeline, but I received a lot of weird pushback from non-Native entertainment industry folks whenever I tried to be more open about my culture. The only time a lot of big television execs, producers, agents, and managers would meet with me or my Native comedian friends was with token meetings in November, which is Native American Heritage Month. One time when I pitched a Native television show to a big animation production company a few years ago, the development executive spent the meeting asking me how to say hello in my Native language, and then spent the rest of the meeting asking me questions like if his hometown in Ohio was named after a Native word, which, I don't know, man, you're from Ohio. My tribe's from Washington State. Why are you asking me? These aren't what I would consider like real opportunities. I would often be told by executives, agents, managers, and producers that I was the first Native person that they'd ever heard a pitch or taken a meeting with. I used to think that was cool and made me unique, until I realized that the people telling me that were often in their 50s and 60s, and that it took them 40 years into their careers to meet with a Native person is not a good look for them. After a few years, I tried to get the Upright Citizens Brigade Theater, one of the biggest comedy theaters in the world, to let me produce an all-Native comedy showcase, a first-of-its-kind show in UCB's 25-year history. But they told me that there wasn't any spots on the calendar for it. Meanwhile, they booked a dozen Star Wars comedy bit shows in 1 week. Though I do agree that Star Wars fans are a marginalized group we should all be catering to, it was really disheartening for a long time to try to tell any Native stories in Hollywood. Finally, after about 5 years of pushing for it, UCB let me produce and host my all-Native comedy show. It was on Columbus Day, because of course it was. The show was called The Ghost of Christopher Columbus Theater Smudging Spectacular, with the joke being that every year the ghost of Columbus rises from his grave to torment Native people, and the only thing that could scare him back to hell are jokes from Native comedians. There's a photo of me and a bunch of the other comedians from the show, 20 comedians or so from tribes all over the country, all standing over Columbus's dead body at the end of the show. The show was a standing room only sellout, and because there had never been an all-Native comedy show at UCB, it was weirdly historic. This comedy show in a 100-seat black box theater in Hollywood drew national media attention. And because I hosted and produced the show, there's a chapter about me in the book, We Had a Little Real Estate Problem, The Unheralded Story of Native Americans in Comedy, which is a book about the history of Native comedy written by Clift Nesteroff that came out through Simon & Schuster in 2021. While this was happening, I figured that if the entertainment industry wasn't going to give me opportunities to tell Native stories, I'd make my own opportunities. I wrote and self-distributed a comedy satire zine called The American Indian Ready-to-Wear Catalog 2018, which was a parody of fashion catalogs where all the models are racist Native stereotypes in the media. Like, for example, the Disney's Pocahontas look, which asks, if you can't talk to animals and a tree isn't your best friend, are you really Native? I also wrote, produced, and directed the animated short that was mentioned in my intro that was inspired by a time I saw a Facebook event for a Native-run protest against the, at the time, unfortunately named Washington, D.C. NFL team. A guy commented on the event saying something to the effect of, I just got a DNA test in the mail that says I'm 1/16th Indian, and I think the team name is fine, so everybody lay off, which we can all agree is a really great take. So I saw this guy's response to this protest, and I really wanted to point him towards something to help educate him without lecturing him. Nothing really existed with the tone that I had in mind, so I made my own. Let's check it out.
Telling people you're Native American when you're not Native is a lot like telling a bear you're a bear when you're not a bear. If you tell a bear you're a bear when you're not a bear, you will get mauled by that bear. If you wear the traditional clothing of a bear when telling a bear that you are also a bear, you'll get mauled by that bear. If you tell a bear you're 1/16th bear, but you don't know what kind of bear, and you've never bothered to research your bear culture, and yet you think you have more right to an opinion about bear issues than the actual bear standing in front of you, you're gonna get mauled by that bear. If you make products with a bear's face on it, and even though you've made $1 billion off of it, and the bear has clearly said they don't like it, and you don't give any of the money you've earned to bears in need until you're guilted into it decades after you started doing it, you and that bear are fine. Just kidding. You're gonna get mauled by that bear. If you tell a bear that lions are your spirit animal, you're gonna get mauled by that bear. And the lion. If you, a non-bear, make friends with a bear, learn their bear culture and language, and then get mad when the bear doesn't ask you to be a member of their bear clan or give you a bear naming ceremony, you're gonna get mauled by that bear. Also, bears don't have naming ceremonies, so that request is stupid. And if you tell people you're a bear, even though you know full well that you're not a bear, just to get jobs and opportunities that are set aside for bears, you're gonna get mauled by a butterfly. The bear would maul you, but he's in a business meeting. Wait, meeting's over.
Hey, I thought we were
So, in conclusion, if you're cool to Native Americans, you will not get mauled by a bear. The end. No white guys were harmed in making this show.
Yep, the name of that short is 24 words long, which is basically a Fiona Apple album title of a short, if there ever was one. And I think that short really proved the point that it's very fun to watch a bear maul a guy over and over again. The thing about all these projects is they all kind of blew up. That short was viewed over 4 million times across social media and was featured everywhere from Just for Laughs to the Smithsonian Museum. Because whenever a Native makes comedy, you just got to immediately throw that into a museum, I guess. My comedy zine sold out 5 pressings and was stocked internationally. I was interviewed by NPR, CNN, The Washington Post, and a lot of other big publications about Native comedy. And with a lot of these publications, I was often the first Native person they'd ever featured or interviewed. So there's a lot of context that I needed to include. There are around 10 million Native people on the US Census, which is similar in population size to the Chinese American population and the Jewish American population, but were referred to as an invisible minority because aside from racist sports mascots and old Westerns where we're shot in the back by John Wayne, we received next to no representation in the media. And due to the US government's centuries-long efforts to boil Native history down to the Pilgrims showed up, and the Natives gave them a big Thanksgiving dinner and the keys to the continent, said peace, and then disappeared like Force ghosts from Star Wars, we're not really taught about in schools either. Unless you count making hand turkeys the week of Thanksgiving in first grade as Native history, which you really, really shouldn't. According to a study by the great Native run nonprofit Illuminative, 87% of US schools don't teach Native history past 1900. This lack of education around Native issues is, I think, a big reason for these microaggressions that a lot of us Native folks deal with. I've been asked by grown adults everything from if I get free money from the government to if I was born in a teepee, which I'm from Washington State, so the question they should have been asking is not if I was born in a teepee, it was, were you born in a longhouse? And the answer to that was, I was born in the 80s, so no, I was born in a hospital. What I do comedically is not representative of all Native comedy. We're not a monolith, there are a few hundred Native comedians actively performing out in the world, but since Native comedy is for the first time really starting to enter the mainstream, I think a lot of people want us to define what Native comedy is. It's weird, you never ask a white comedian to explain what white comedy is. Maybe it's all jokes about airline food? I don't know. I like to define Native comedy as really just any comedy done by a Native person. Res comedy, on the other hand, or comedy prominent on reservations, is a lot of teasing and a lot of roasting. Growing up on the res, I'd always hear folks hitting each other with a sick roast joke, and then punctuating it with an A to show that they were just messing around. And definitely a lot of people have gotten those A roasts, I'm sure. Res comedy can also get pretty dark at times. If you hang out with a group of Native comedians for too long, it's not weird for the tone to just shift from silly jokes to jokes about hardcore Native trauma just in the blink of an eye. It's just like, non-Native comedians will tell me it's always wild when they'll hang out with Native comedians and it's just like, oh, we veered into genocide. We're in a really historic time in Native representation. Just 2 years ago, Rutherford Falls and Reservation Dogs were released, both half-hour sitcoms. Those were the first two shows in United States television history created by a Native person with largely Native creative teams featuring Native characters played by Native actors. That was in 2021. That was not that long ago. Spirit Rangers on the right, that's a show that I'm a writer and consulting producer on, and it was the first kids animated series in the United States created by a Native person, the genius Shumash TV writer Chris of Valencia, with an all-Native writer's room that I'm a part of, and around 100 Native folks in the cast and crew, which I think makes it the largest collected Native team to ever work on an animated television show in recent history, and probably ever. Here are a couple clips from Spirit Rangers.
Summer, Cody, Eddie, as of today, you're officially Junior Park Rangers!
That's the best day of my life!
The Spirit Rangers are here to protect every crook, cranny, and critter! The raining rocks are falling all over the park!
Not the fish, not the fish! Thank you for letting a wing.
I am everyone's favorite spirit, after all.
Not Jim Coyote. The Spirit Rangers.
Another job for the Spirit Rangers. Spirit Rangers.
So fair. I can't see the action.
I think we found the mountain spirit causing the quakes.
Oh, that's no mountain spirit. That's La Wetlatla. In Cowlitz, her name means the smoker. At least that's what your dad calls her. He's always right.
Since when do mountain spirits give off smoke?
They don't. Volcano spirits do.
I've never met a volcano spirit before. Hi, La Wetlatla.
Hey, I'm not just a volcano spirit. I'm an angry volcano spirit because I'm missing the boulder brawl. Everyone is blocking my view, and it's making me hit my boiling point.
We want to get along to keep things chummy.
Don't break your promises. That's really crummy.
Hopper who keeps his word will never end up in someone else's tummy. So you keep your promises before they do stay true. Your grievances, you'll see your treaty through.
You want your friends to keep their promise too, so keep your promises, keep your promises.
Your friends love shitty trees, so it's worth checking.
If all the noise you make is friendship wrecking,
you could explore these worlds.
be amazed. Our dancers have been working hard on a few hoop dance moves.
Eagle?
We practice really hard. Trust me.
How did you do that?
I told you, we practiced. And maybe used a little spirit. Now, let's dance!
You don't have to tell these old hips twice.
Yeah. We got hoop dancing on Netflix. That's crazy. There's a photo of a few of the native folks who worked on Spirit Rangers. It premiered on Netflix in October of 2022, which is really only about 8 months ago. Season 2 came out last month, and Season 3, which was just announced last week, comes out sometime in 2024. I'm so proud of this show. This was the first time in my career I'd worked with an all-Native writers' room on a show in production. Up until fairly recently, shows featuring Native characters rarely featured any Native people in front of or behind the camera at all. I mean, Johnny Depp playing Tano in The Lone Ranger was only like a few years ago. With Spirit Rangers, our goal was to indigenize the production and to make the show the right way. We even went as far as getting the official blessing from the Spirit Rangers showrunner Carissa Valencia's Chumash tribe, and my Cowlitz tribe to include Chumash and Cowlitz characters, words from our languages, and stories inspired by our legends in the show. As thanks, we included the insignias of our tribes in the end credits of the show, which was a first for Netflix, if not all of kids' television. It was also just an incredible experience to work with so many other Native people. One of the things that prevented me from writing Native stories, sketches, and jokes earlier in my career is that whenever I'd try, I'd always have to stop and explain super basic Native stuff before I can get to pitching the joke. A lot of us Native Hollywood folks call it Native 101, because so few non-Natives are educated about basic Native culture, you have to stop and explain every joke to non-Natives. And it really slows down the comedy when you're pitching a joke about fry bread, and you have to stop and explain to everyone what fry bread is. And if you're wondering what fry bread is right now, first off, how dare you? Second off, it's exactly what it sounds like. With Spirit Rangers, because there were a lot of Native people on the team in every aspect of the production, we were able to really dig in and write episodes about the nuances of Native culture. We also guilted Netflix into giving us Indigenous Peoples Day off every year so we could go eat fry bread tacos in a park in LA, but that's neither here nor there. It was just a nice time. With our all-Native writers room, I was able to write a lot of firsts in kids' television, like an episode about why Native sports mascots are weird, or an episode about hoop dancing, which you saw a clip of, which is this amazing art form I saw all the time on the Tulalip Reservation growing up. Another episode I wrote was called Broken Treaties, which was an episode about why it's important the U.S. government honor its treaties with tribes. This is all for a show meant for four-year-olds, and I don't think I would have been able to tackle these important topics if there weren't so many Native folks on the team. Having a largely Native team allowed us to have nuanced and productive conversations about these topics, where we didn't have to have the conversation with training wheels on, and I think that quality and care really showed in every Spirit Rangers episode. I feel so lucky to get to do what I do. When I was a kid, I didn't think I was allowed to work in comedy because I didn't see any Native comedians on television. Now I'm a working television writer, working with a lot of other Native folks to make the kinds of shows we wish existed when we were kids. I even created my own digital series with Comedy Central called Gone Native that premiered on Comedy Central social channels earlier this year. You can check out all our episodes at gonenative.tv. It's super funny. It's a series of comedy PSAs about kind of weird microaggressions that Native folks often deal with. And the Bear Short that I played a few minutes ago was the first episode. Other episodes are about Native sports mascots, the Indian burial ground trope. And one of my favorites is called, Every Time You Say Something Is Your Spirit Animal, You Have to Give Every Native American Person You Know $25. So far, no one has written me a check for $25 after seeing that short, but I'm waiting. There's so much ignorance and weird assumptions about Native people and how we live our lives. I originally started making these shorts because I'd see non-Natives digging their heels in about the craziest stuff. You know, calling something a powwow when it's really just a boring work meeting, claiming a false Native identity and then immediately trying to benefit from it, and a million other examples. I felt like whenever this sort of thing happened, My friends and I were often forced into a teaching role where it became our job to educate people about these microaggressions and why they're not okay. It's exhausting work that we're not paid for. And the only resources that I could really find to help teach non-natives about these issues were just longer think pieces. I figured that I probably wasn't going to be able to convince someone to read a long think piece about a complex native issue, but I might be able to get them to watch like a silly 2-minute comedy short packed with jokes to educate them, so I don't have to have that conversation. Through this process, I learned that comedy is actually a really effective tool for social change. If you try to teach someone a lesson or correct someone for saying something weird or offensive, they'll often shut down or tune you out, but if you wrap it in comedy, it's like when you hide medicine in a big pile of candy, it just makes the whole thing way easier to swallow. Ultimately, my goal for my career is that I want to create work that can give funny Native kids on reservations who don't feel like they have a ton of options the permission to dream that I wish I had as a kid. I want to inspire Native folks that their stories can exist in the mainstream. And I always thought that this was a lifelong goal that I'd achieve late in my career, but due to these Native-created TV shows being announced and coming out recently, it's happening right now. Since all these Native shows have been released over the past 2 years, tons of podcasts, TikTok accounts, and YouTube channels have started, created by Native folks because they're finally seeing people like them on TV, telling funny stories they relate to. And because of that, they're excited to give the entertainment industry a try. And they didn't even have to go to college to be a small market TV weather guy or create a Facebook group for LA comedians to share pictures of their cats to do it. And though we still haven't had a Native stand-up comedian on a late night show in nearly 2 decades, I think decision makers in Hollywood are finally starting to become aware of their blind spots, and it's only a matter of time before Native comedians get those opportunities. In 2020, just 3 years ago, there had never been a Native comedy show on American television. There were major sports teams named after straight-up racial slurs against Native people, and we'd never in the history of this country ever had a Native person hold a secretary-level position in a U.S. presidential cabinet. Now, in 2023, teams are changing their mascots. There are 3 Native-created comedy shows on TV and a ton more that are currently in development. And Deb Haaland is the Secretary of the Interior. Plus, the Supreme Court just voted to uphold the Indian Child Welfare Act. That's rad as hell. Yeah, right? Oh, just a little over a decade after I didn't think I was allowed to be a comedian, now I'm working in Hollywood with some of the biggest comedy brands in the world, telling the types of stories and jokes I've always wanted to tell with Native people front and center. And that's the coolest shit ever. Thank you so much. That's my talk. I definitely have a Q&A if anybody has any questions about any of the things I said. Thank you. Okay, any questions or how do you want to do this? Okay, raise your hand or, okay. Questions going once. Okay, right back there.
Chonga.
Oh, okay. Oh man, this is gonna make me look bad. I actually don't have any kids. My roommate's not a cat person. I don't want to like force cats on somebody who doesn't like cats. But the Facebook group is kind of how I experience cat ownership by proxy. Plus, I have a lot of friends who like let me cats and stuff. But someday I will have a cat. Wait, do you have cats?
Yes, I do.
Okay, wait. What are their names?
Mocha.
Ah.
Twinkle and Georgia.
Ah, that's cute. I love food names, and like food names are such a good thing for cats. It's just immediately cute if you name a cat like Sandwich or something.
I have one named
Peanut. Yay. Okay, wait, any other questions? Okay, wait, is this about cats?
No.
Okay. Wait, anybody, any other questions? Just kidding. Okay. Okay, yeah, what do you got?
If you know someone, like I have a cousin who's really crazy, and he's Kiowa. If there was any, do you have any interest in how could I get put
him
in touch with some kind of company like yours that might do some jokes or?
Yeah, wait. How old is he?
I think he's like 58.
Oh, got it. Oh, okay, got it. So like, I'm always down to. So like, Hollywood is it's a very like windy industry to get involved with, but. I think that we're in a really nice spot in Native Hollywood where because like stories, like we're seeing like Native TV shows created by the first time with like big Native creative teams. There is this big demand for like Native writers and Native comedians. And a lot of people are getting like really great first opportunities to work on these shows. So like, you know, I would say like come up to me afterwards, definitely get my email. I can't like give them a job or anything because I don't have anything in production, but I'm always happy to like, you know, answer questions or point people towards stuff. Like there's some really good writing labs and writing television writing fellowships and stuff like that that are like native run that are a good way that people are getting their foot in the door. Thank you. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. All right, go for it.
Is there a writer's strike right now?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's a really good question. So yeah, the Writers Guild of America is currently on strike. They're the union that covers most productions in Los Angeles. I'm a member of the Animation Guild, which is a union that covers writing and animation stuff like that for most animation productions. Spirit Rangers is an Animation Guild show, so we're not affected like directly by the strike. But that said, like we're all very supportive and like you know, I mean, it's not to get on my soapbox on all this stuff, but it's like writers, for the value that we put into the world, it's like we're definitely not paid as much as we should be, especially when you see like, I think that, yeah, especially when you see like the 8 CEOs of the big studios earn like $800 million a year combined, when like the writers make, you know, like, when like, I have a lot of friends who are writers who are like struggling to pay the rent, you know? So, you know, it is definitely, you know, I think it's a needed strike, and you know, that is definitely like a conversation that me and a lot of friends have about like, oh, it's like we're just hitting this point where like native stories are in the mainstream and getting these opportunities. But I think that we've hit a nice point where I feel like we're like established. Like Reservation Dogs is a hit show, and like there's nothing that's gonna cause them to stop making Reservation Dogs. They're gonna definitely go on pause due to the strike as far as the writing and stuff goes. And there are a lot of other native shows in production that I think that like the industry is excited about, and it's like there's definitely, you know, going to be a pause of, you know, a few to a bunch of months where we can't like actively write or develop these shows, but like I don't see it affecting us more or less than any of the other shows happening. But that's a good question. That's definitely like, you know, ultimately I mean I want everybody to get their fair shake and be paid what they deserve, but I'm also like, oh, I hope this doesn't affect native stuff, but I don't think it's going to. Hey, got a question.
Hi, I'm Gab.
Oh, good to meet you.
I'm from the tribe right north of Chumash. So how many actual California Indians are working in Hollywood? And do you think we're going to see more, you know, like diversity of Native cultures in represented in shows? I mean, I've heard you say there's like one Chumash person in Spirit Rangers, but I don't get Netflix, so.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, and this is something that like we talk about a lot in the, you know, like the Native folks in the room know there's like 574 tribes that are fairly recognized, hundreds more at the state level. And like, you know, like I love Reservation Dogs. It's a great show, but Reservation Dogs is like so Oklahoma, you know? And I grew up on like a res in Washington State. So it's like the Reservation Dogs experience, it isn't exactly my experience. Or even just me is like, an urban native dork living in LA, you know? And, you know, my goal, or my hope, and I think that like a lot of other Native Hollywood folks share this feeling, is that like, we have three Native shows on TV right now. I want there to be 300 Native shows in 10 years so that we can have shows that are reflective to like, you know, Northeast tribes, to like the Diné people, to like, you know, Pacific Northwest tribes, to like, you know, like there's so many tribes that are California-based, to like, you know, having California tribes that are, there's diversity even within tribes. It's like my boss's experience, or my experience as like a Cowlitz, enrolled Cowlitz tribal member living in LA is way different than the experience of like a Cowlitz tribal member living in Southern Washington, you know? So that's definitely my hope, is to, you know, keep pushing and keep on, you know, pitching and creating my own ideas, but also like trying to bring up other people as much as I can from other tribes and from other, you know, like urban Native folks, res Native folks, and et cetera, so that we can have more of like a diversity of Native storytelling out there in the media, just even within like Indian country. And then as far as other California people, I mean, like Carissa, she's the first Native person to ever be the showrunner creator of a kids animated series. So she's a Southern California Native person, or a member of Southern California tribe, and she's like the highest ranking animation person. So she's gonna definitely have a lot of like power and sway to like, you know, get things produced and pitch things and stuff like that. I think that she was just on like, she was named one of Variety's like 20 animators to watch last year or something. So she's like, her clout is raising up. And I think that she definitely has an attitude of like trying to bring up other Native folks, but also trying to showcase other California Native stories and other California Native people. I mean, like those are conversations that we had on Spirit Rangers, where it's like, you know, we definitely have a lot of Chumash stories, in the show because it's, you know, the creator of Chumash, and she has easy access to like talking to Chumash elders and stuff like that. But we definitely like tried to feature other California tribes in the show to make sure that it wasn't just Chumash people and that's it. And there's like definitely other Southern California folks, there's Carissa, there's a guy named Brian Arnett, who is a really great Native animator who's worked on a ton of shows for a while. And he's, I think he's also Chumash. And then there's, Jolie Proudfit, who is the consultant on Spirit Rangers. She's from another Southern California tribe. I forget which one it is, but it's like San Diego's the Aboriginal territory. Lusenia. Yeah, Lusenia, yeah. And, there's definitely like Dash Turner is Karak. He was a writer on Rutherford Falls. And he's currently writing like Solar Opposites. So, you know, it's like, we're definitely like early stages and Native folks getting these opportunities. But I think that just offhand, there's like Native folks from like Southern California, Central California, Northern California, who are like making their way up in the industry, you know?
The reason I'm asking is it would be so cool to have a show about the actual Indians of the LA Basin.
Yeah.
They're there.
Yeah.
I didn't even notice they're there until they did the big Tongva land exhibit, you know, the public art exhibit all over town.
Oh, yeah.
The Gabriel Animals.
Yeah. Well, I think that's something that, like, something that I really like about Native Hollywood is that I feel like we're all like Native folks. We're all like sensitive to that. And it's like, you know, it's like if I write a show that takes place in LA and has Native folks, there's for sure going to be Tongva characters in that show, because otherwise it would be like weird and I wouldn't feel okay with that, you know? There's definitely progress being made, I think. And we're all trying to push forward that stuff. Any other questions? Going once, going twice. Any other cat stories? Cool. Thanks so much for having me. Stephen Paul Judd, amazing Native visual artist and comedian, TV writer, is doing a talk tomorrow. And Jackie Kalia, who's a super funny Native comedian, is doing a talk, I believe, on Thursday. And there's a Native comedy show.
Sierra Norris.
Oh, really? Wow. Yeah. Wait, when's she? Wait,
she's going to be talking with Jackie.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah, Sarah Taylor Niles, who created Rutherford Falls. So there's a lot of great stuff, so definitely go and see all the other stuff that happened this week, too. But yeah, thanks for having me. This was great.
Thank you for joining us this evening. We hope you enjoyed the lecture and learned a few things and had a few laughs along the way. Be sure to visit our website for future online lecture series. Yeah, thank you.